Macmillan Audio presents State Tectonics by Malka Older, read for you by Christine Marshall. For Lou, Calyx, Paz. Chapter 1. The Dhaka street swarms with people, objects, and all of the existing data about all of these people and objects. Miriam, who of all people should be accustomed to words and numbers floating in front of her eyes, finds herself brushing at her face, as if to wipe away all that accumulated knowledge. It's too much. She turns on first one filter, removing any data uploaded before the last global election, then another that she rigged especially for this trip, muting personal data that is not directly related to her mission. But Miriam is a believer in fate and coincidence and a childhood reader of Dirk Gently's holistic detective agency, and she can't escape the concern that her algorithm might exclude something vitally important. Miserably, she turns the second filter back off again. A few months ago, a ban on high-emissions vehicles, already the norm in most of the world, was finally enacted for all of micro-democracy. Dhaka included a concentration of particularly recalcitrant sentinel governments, and the moment the law took force, the streets emptied out and transportation, particularly of goods, became scarce. The fool responded immediately, taking over the pavement with no regard for the likelihood that cleaner motor vehicles would pick up the slack. Sidewalks, suddenly unnecessary for pedestrians, became valuable real estate, and capsule apartments were built in front of existing buildings, barely leaving access to the entrances. Hovels sprang up in front of the capsule apartments, sometimes sloping off the ill-repaired sidewalks into the street proper. The garbage collection system had been largely diesel-based, and although a team of rickshaw collectors now supplements the rag-pickers who never stopped searching for anything worth selling, they are making little headway against the mountains of garbage that lean against walls and spill into the street. A massive vehicle, retrofitted to scrape past the new standards, is forcing its way through the human-clogged artery that remains between all these obstacles, and its slow progress is pushing Miriam and, it seems, the entire population of the flooded delta of Bangladesh into the walls and the garbage and the shacks and each other. This is not a context in which Miriam feels particularly comfortable. She grew up in Beirut and Paris and pre-earthquake Lima, and in decidedly comfortable segments of each, and until recently lived in sparsely populated Doha. She itches to deploy her crowd cutter, a translucent shell shaped like a shark fin that would not only give her a literal edge in moving forward, but also isolate her from the press of bodies. But she left herself plenty of time to get to the sanatorium, and she doesn't want to attract any more attention than necessary. Anyone could be watching her, following her from feed to feed, broadcast by microscopic cameras. But there are a lot of feeds in the world, a lot of people to watch. If no one is paying attention to Miriam, she doesn't want to give them a reason to start. And maybe this crowd is thick enough to get lost in. Cheering someone at the thought, she pulls her scarf lower over her forehead and presses on. Miriam locates the sanatorium a few streets over. The neighborhood has taken a disorientingly quick shift for the better. It isn't one of the new wealth enclaves with wide streets and gatehouses for armed guards, but the venerable residences are at least cared for enough to fend off the outgrowth of slums on the sidewalks. Miriam passes through a gate with the code she was given when she made her appointment, and then through a courtyard, hazy in the heat, to find the entrance proper. A plaque, an actual plaque, not projected or painted, but engraved, explains the concept of time capsule therapy and gives a brief history of its development, lists the names of major benefactors, including information, Miriam notes with surprise. Some of her bosses must be worried about aging, too. And mentions the date of establishment, 2053. Miriam shivers at the thought of two decades crawling by while those within live frozen in the knots. She pushes open the heavy door and walks in. She finds herself in a large turquoise room with multiple closed doors leading off of it, a well-appointed reception center. Miriam had braced herself for the shock of stepping into a period drama, but everything seems normal. The receptionist is blinking through some data at eyeball level. An infotainment projection plays soundlessly in one corner, and the light fixtures in the ceiling are fluoron. Miriam gives her name to the receptionist, a skinny young man with luxuriant hair, and a few minutes later, a small woman in her 40s wearing a rose and green sari comes out to meet her.
"Welcome to the Growling Knots," she greets her. "Saleh Rashid, we just have a few procedures we need to go through before you can go on to your appointment."
"Yes," Miriam agrees. "I have some projections that I believe I need transferred."
"To compatible technology. We can help you there."
Saleha leads her to a small office with an old-fashioned computer on a desk next to the workspace.
"In fact, it was Taskeen who built the translation protocol early in her stay here."
Miriam smiles. That bodes well. Intent on keeping up with events, was she?
"We don't forbid that, you know. Our clients are not institutionalized, and they are free to communicate with the outside world in any way they wish," Saleha explains as she works with the projection files Miriam tossed her. "We maintain temporal continuity in all the public spaces of the premises, however, which is why we need to check all of your modern devices here."
Miriam divests herself of her personal projector and handheld.
"You can keep your auto-interpreter since it's not visible, but Taskeen won't be wearing one. Will you need an interpreter? We have several on staff."
"We'll be fine," Miriam says, hoping that's true. Her English is not great, and she has no Bengali, but she can't take the risk of an interpreter and prefers not to advertise that her discussion with Taskeen Khan, creator of the information data pathways and a personal hero, is going to be highly classified. Saleha hands Miriam a flat device about the size of her thumb, with a metal connector at one end.
"Your projections are on this, or an approximation of them. You can use it with Taskeen's computer." She studies Miriam. "But before we go, I'm afraid you'll have to do something about your clothes as well." Miriam looks down at herself. She is wearing much what she always wears, a black salwar kameez in pseudo-silk. The kameez is knee-length, with a simple micro-cutout pattern around the collar and cuffs, matching the dupatta she wears over her head. "You can look like a foreigner, but you must be a foreigner from the turn of the century," Saleha clucks. "The pseudo-silk, the heat reflectors, the micro-cutouts. It's subtle, but believe me, someone from the past would notice. We have alternate clothing available." She opens a large cabinet to display a rack of colors and fabrics. "I'll be right outside. You can, of course, keep anything of your own that isn't visible," she adds as she closes the door behind her.
Miriam flips through the hangers, looking for something muted in the array of flowery fabrics and bright colors. Maybe this is an opportunity to cosplay a bit, even if it is a work meeting. She picks a style she recognizes from old movies, a full-skirted chemise and tight trousers in a bold geometric pattern. She looks around for a feed camera, remembers where she is, and grabs her handheld off Saleha's desk to take a picture of herself and send it to Nuria. There's a knock on the door.
"All set?" Miriam quickly puts her handheld back and opens the door to Saleha's pleasant smile. "Shall we go meet her?"
Saleha leads her through the door behind the receptionist, which opens onto a city street. Miriam blinks in surprise, and then blinks again. Information's detailed annotations and input don't appear, and the world looks strange. The vehicles parked on the sides of the street are all from the turn of the century, resting on pitted asphalt. Thick bundles of black wires sway above her head, suspended on posts, with subsidiary lines branching off toward each of the buildings. Posters, two-dimensional and unmoving, for ancient movies and long-discontinued products, like chewing gum and disposable razors, are plastered to the walls.
"A bit disconcerting, isn't it?"
Saleha asks. "You must be used to it," Miriam says, not wanting to admit how strange it feels to walk into the past.
"Indeed. I've come to quite enjoy the shift." "Are all these houses real?" Miriam asks, gesturing at the 3- and 4-story buildings on each side of the road. "Yes, we were able to purchase a block that hadn't been substantially upgraded since the early part of the century, although we did have to retrofit some of the accoutrements, like the electricity lines." Saleha nods at the sagging wires overhead. and we made some alterations to close off our campus. There are no entrances other than our official ones, although it's not something you'd notice. We have simulacra of televisions that show contemporary programming on a set annual schedule and, oh, you'll appreciate this, she says, with the confidence of someone who believes everyone who works in tech is interested in all aspects of technology. We have a purpose-built model of the 2010 internet with custom blockers that can set it to any year until 2005, completely self-contained. Miriam does appreciate that. Very impressive. Yes. Of course, Taskeen helped us with that, too. It is strange to hear Dr. Khan, the visionary, academic, and technical genius, referred to so casually as someone who helped with a nursing home intranet. And the shops? Miriam asks. The building they are passing has a small grocery store on the ground floor, doors open for business, and in the one next to it she sees a jewelry shop. Do you bring people in to staff them? The businesses are all run by residents, Saleha says, with a tilt of pride in her voice. They work? It must cost a fortune to live in this facility, and the octo and nonagenarians still have to hold down jobs? Only the ones who want to. And of course they keep what they earn. We find that many of our residents crave occupation, and having a local economy is beneficial for the neighborhood. Of course it's a lot of work to manage it. You mean subsidies? There's a great deal of arbitrage involved in getting the goods into this system and making them available for prices that make sense in the currency of the time. We offer some subsidies, especially for old products that we've had to commission, but there are also many administrative issues. But it's certainly worth it. Those who want jobs can have them, and everyone can shop within our campus rather than simply receiving goods from us. You sound sold on this place, Miriam says. Does it really work? Saleha smiles. I've already invested in my spot in the sliding 40s. You'll see, she adds as they turn into the entrance of a small building to the right. They climb 3 flights of stairs. Seems like a lot for an elderly woman to have to do every day. And Saleha knocks on the door. Taskeen, she calls. I've brought you a visitor. The door opens wide. The woman standing inside is small but upright. Her hair is black, but she probably modifies it, or dyes it. That's what people did at the turn of the century. She's wearing thick glasses and a warm smile that could be described as grandmotherly. Her skin looks soft and is slathered with artificial coloring, blush, lipstick, but without knowing her age, Miriam probably would have guessed her to be in her 50s, or even 40s. Come in, come in, Taskeen Khan says, stepping back so they can enter a narrow hallway bathed in warm colors from the cloth hangings on the walls. She gives Saleha a hug and takes Miriam's hand in both of hers. I was just about to make tea. Miriam sends Saleha a look that she hopes is not too rude. She needs Taskeen to herself, and her time is limited. Thank you, Saleha clucks. But I have to be getting back to the office. I'll leave you to it, and stop by sometime tomorrow. After the door closes, Taskeen appraises Miriam with sharp eyes. So, you're the hot new techie. I don't know, Miriam says, surprised. There are always hotter and newer ones coming along. Taskeen laughs, holds up her hands. Sadly, I don't speak Arabic, although I always wanted to learn, she says. English, perhaps? She adds in that language, turning to lead Miriam down a short hall. My English is not so good, Miriam says, cringing at her own awful accent. Francais? No, Taskeen says. I'll make you some chai, yes? Her volume has gone up a notch, even though she knows Miriam can understand her perfectly. Don't worry, we have options. I've made some modifications to the era-appropriate translation software. She throws a wink at Miriam as she fills the kettle. It's still a bit clunky, but we can use that. ¿No entiendes español, acaso? Miriam asks. Oh, Taskeen turns, kettle still in her hand. Do you know, I believe I still do. I'd be hard-pressed to speak it, but... She turns back and fiddles with the gas stove, humming to herself. Yes, let's try it. I speak whatever I want, and you speak Spanish, and if we get into trouble, we'll use the translator, although we'll have to go into the other room for that. Nodding happily, she guides Miriam through an entranceway into a small study.
A curtained window looks out on the street, but most of the wall is taken up by banks of humming electronics, and a large, old-fashioned computer monitor sits between them, a keyboard on the desk below it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.